Going to talk about my diploma program. I started that program in 2013. I was hired to set up five new courses, develop five new brand new courses, and then integrated some of the other courses to create a diploma in leadership, governance, and human rights for the first time at USP. And I think in the Pacific Island itself, it's the first program ever. And none of the other universities in the Pacific provide those courses. And this is also an important thing because it's not a postgraduate level course, it's an undergraduate level course. And I think when I started writing, RSD was being heard at university, right? So when we were sending in, a whole lot of paperwork to ISU, whatever, so many Q's committees there are at USC that you have to go through. And once we went through that, they said, okay, there's a new criteria, and the forms keep changing. I don't know why they keep changing the form. So you pass it through one committee, the next committee can you integrate this part? I said, okay, the nightmare begins again. So they said, can you integrate RSD into your courses? I said, okay, this is fantastic because it's a new course. It's easier to integrate things in a new course than an old course that's existing. So all our five courses, I think I can say our program is the only program that has got RSD in all our core courses. Am I correct in that?
No.
No? Which other programs do that?
Social work.
Social work. Okay, they've got that too now. So I think when we were doing it in 2013, we were the only one. So I'm probably claiming that. But I'm going to focus on the 300 level course, which is an internship course. And the rest of the other courses, we've already integrated it and we do different assessments, but I'm not going to focus on that. So And when we started developing the rubric, we had that framework that John provided, and we had an initial discussion with John and a number of other colleagues at USP, and we were always taken to posh hotels for that, for some reason, because we inside, get involved, we're not going to pay you anything, but put some extra work and we'll give you some meals. But we ended up, I had just come from University of York in UK, and we had developed a rubric somewhat similar in there for a course. So immediately I thought, I'm not going to start from scratch. I'm going to use something that's existing already. And this was also common creative work that we had done with others. So I have to acknowledge University of York colleagues that we have worked together on that. And what we did was and this is, by the way, it comes on an A3 size paper. So it's quite wordy. It's interesting because it's general enough, so you can cover it for reflective work, you can cover it for assignments, you can cover it for essays, a number of different things. But immediately I realized students were not familiar with the word facets. They didn't know what is facets. Facets is a new terminology. Research has always been assessed at USP and will continue to be assessed, but it was not formalized and the terminologies were different. So immediately we had to tweak the rubric that I had initially created and integrate the elements that students were familiar with. So when I'm saying to students, I'm not saying, go ahead and park and clarify or find and generate. That's not the terminology. It just doesn't exist in the assessment. They will say, what the heck are you talking about? I'm not going to embark and clarify and say, don't you shit. We need to start with an introduction. Introduction is a technology that's familiar to them. They know that. They've done that. They've done that for the last 5-6 years in high school. So we have to tweak it to match to the technologies they're familiar with. And I think that's important because sometimes if we start something new, we have to look at who's the customer base. Are we actually sending the message to them? Do they really understand? If we're forcing our ideas just from top-down approach, it doesn't work. So immediately we had to tweak that, and I think after that it worked because they could understand where I'm coming from. And when I'm saying logical organization, I'm talking about analysis and synthesis, right? Something that, I'm coming back to the 300 level course that we have, and I'm going to talk specifically about that particular course. It's a capstone course. Hina initially was saying about the different levels of graduate attributes, and that's the capstone. It's sort of by the end of the program, you should have achieved all of this, and that's kind of the final course most students do. Usually, because each student is allowed to do an individual different research, we don't encourage more than 15 to 18 students. anybody who's supervised research, you'd understand the nightmare that goes with individual research. If it's a set assignment, you give a particular topic, it's easy because you don't have to read all the other materials to mark assessments. But we found out that huge number of students are interested in it. So last year, we had to deregister 45 students. And students would come to my office, no, I want to do this particular course. I said, I'm sorry, you do not meet the prerequisites. We're strictly implementing the prerequisites because we just could not handle the amount of work that went into it. Again, I think that's one of the challenges. When we do integrate new assessment methods, we integrate new things, we want to develop the capacity, but we have to realize that academics work also increases with that. So that is a challenge that I think has not been faced. I'm not being really addressed by the senior management team, and if somebody is sitting here, please take notes. And also, all our 5 DG courses are offered in all the campuses. So again, the challenges of offering DFL courses, blended mode courses, it's easier sometimes to offer courses face-to-face, but it's more difficult. We need to also realize the challenges on the campuses. I require all the students to be able to do an SPSS assignment. Majority of the campuses do not have that in the computers. So some practical challenges that goes with it. So I've had students in Lohana, Lotoka, Lambasa, English, Honera, Alapua, Tonga, Niue already. And I think next semester we'll be offering it again. We offer it every second semester, and we probably see different students. I'm sorry this did not come out, but we in the 300 level internship course, we have 7 different assessments. It's a 100% assessment course. So we have tutorials. This is for communication, and it's also just to find out if the students are on the right track. So we have formal presentations in that. Usually we start with formal, whatever particular topic the students are interested to know. So if they're doing something on literature review, I present about 45 minutes to an hour on what is a literature review. Then the next 1 hour is open for discussion, and we'll talk a lot. And it is via Skype, via satellite tutorial. Sometimes I have to do Skype tutorials as well because students are not able to come out on time for that. Second one is literature review. And again, I'm going to, I think I've shown in there, this is probably a better one. So in literature review, we look at, we look at embarking, clarify, evaluate, and reflect, organize, and manage, and analyze, and synthesize. But having said that, we don't assess that equally. The focus for literature review is basically evaluate and reflect. So more marks is given on that particular facet. I think it's impossible to equally assess all facets in all different assignments. So you have to pick and choose which one. So when we're doing SPSS PowerPoint presentation, again, if you look at the PowerPoint presentation scope, well, this is sort of the rubric for it in the marking, but not in the RSD terminologies, the terminologies they were familiar with. We're doing a lot of focus. A lot of focus is going on the presentation, style, dictation, body language, time, and response. Content is there, but the weighting is more on the presentation scope, the style of it. And I think that's, again, very important. I think all of you sitting in here would realize in Pacific, a lot of people are very afraid and not good public speakers initially when they come into university, and it's a skill we have to develop as part of research as well. So I'm going to now focus on a case of a student I have. He's just about to finish. I think he's got a few courses to go before he finishes. I'm using a different name because I haven't had his consent yet. I think he hasn't checked his email after his last email on Thursday to me. He only completed class 6, and when he entered USP, he was 54 years old. He entered USP, for those outside of USP, there's a mature student entry criteria where if you have not have a formal education completed up to year 12 or year 13, you can still enter USP through your experience, and if somebody vouches for you, usually. So, Abisai entered our program as a mature student category, and I'm invited in today. I don't see him here. This is Tony, is quite busy. He was catching and selling crabs and fish for his entire life. He dropped out of school, later on got married, had kids. When the kids grew up and they asked him, what do you want to do? You know, you don't have to self-prep anymore, do you want to do something? He said he wants to go to USP. What a desperation. You know, it's remarkable, it is fascinating, and I'm happy that I have students like that coming to my program. Because when he entered the program, the first course that I taught him was DG100 at that time, or was it 101? I think Andre was already in the team. I really struggled with these assignments because he's never written academic essays. He's probably never written a report. So really, really struggled in, see, every time he would mark an assignment, I'd call him over and I said, we have to have a discussion. You do not write like this. Have to send him to SLS. We'll sit with the rubric, explain what is an introduction, what goes in an introduction, show him a video from YouTube. This is how introduction is broken down. And he was like a sponge. I think sometimes when we get education quite freely and easily, we do not appreciate it. He did not get that, and he really, really appreciated that effort. He went extra mile to work hard to get better marks. Now, I think he's an outstanding example because now he's getting, he got an A in this course. He got an A in a research course, which most other students struggle. And he's constantly getting B plus, B in other courses, in not only my DG courses, but other courses as well. And he's currently, he's a part-time student, so he's not doing full-time. He should have finished by now if it was full-time, but he's still, so he's about to
finish soon.
His research was on the integration of ex-prisoners. Because when the prisoners come back from prison, are they accepted back in the community? And there was a lot of focus on the sexual crimes, and they were focusing on that particular aspect of the prisoners as well. What was the acceptability rate? Do they get accepted in the community? If they don't, do they become criminals again because they don't have a source of income or acceptance? Do they get any kind of formal training to get into sort of reintegrate back in the community? So it was a very, very fascinating report, and he was placed with an organization called OCAF. OCAF is an organization run by a guy in, he used to work in ILO, but he's now opened up an NGO that covers from Nosori to Reki Reki to all grassroots NGOs. Very well experienced guy, has got a huge experience and was able to mentor and sort of nurture his Apisai's interest in that particular area. And he was also wanting Apisai on his board, on his team, because Apisai has got some clout now in his community. He is actually the spokesperson for the rural council, if I'm not wrong, at the moment. So I think the sister at the back was telling me that she might know him. I said, I'm not revealing his name because I cannot do that at the moment. But he presented this report at the rural provincial council last year, and his findings are now being formalized. This is the email I got on Thursday last week. And he said that he's actually formalized and registered framework here as an NGO. So something very tangible out of that research. To me, I come from a development background. I've worked with NGOs before. I like that aspect. I don't think research should gather dust on some table and then be part of a general ranking thing. I think it's important for academics, but not everybody will be an academic. I think practical part of research is very, very important, and I think we need to nurture that aspect. And I'm proud to say that he's able to do that. He's now been involved in the seasonal worker scheme as well, as you can see from the email. So he's able to influence on that aspect, and I think it's fantastic. I also hear that he's been hired by CCF, Citizen Constitutional Forum, on a part-time basis to run human rights workshop. He is a strong advocate for elimination of violence against women now in his community. And I've been hearing from other people who know him, says when he speaks in his community on this sensitive issue, everybody listens. So he's got respect as well, which is hard for people to acquire, but I think they acknowledge that, you know, the amount of effort and time he's put into it. And I think it's a remarkable achievement through this research capacity building that we're talking about, that uplifting the skills of individuals so that they the capacity of the research is not only used for academic, but also outside academic. Thank you very much.